short CV about him. He's completed his MBBS in PhD Coimbatore and Diploma in Dermatology from Royal College of Physicians, Glasgow, and MD Dermatology from Kakatiya Medical College. And he's done his fellowship in National Skin Center, Singapore. And presently, he is the HOD of Dermatology in New York Hospital, Chennai. Please come, sir.
Good evening, dear doctors. I thank IMA for giving me this opportunity. Now, treatment in dermatology has evolved a lot since what it was, say, about a decade back. Now, during my training about 18-20 years back, when I joined dermatology, it was all about how to use steroids. Right now, it is all about how not to use steroids. So that's a big, dramatic difference in the way we treat diseases in the present generation. Now, so my topic is biologics in dermatology. It's a disclaimer. Many of these slides are made by the Novartis team. I thank them for that. And so we know we've been using these biologics for a long time. FDA defines biologics as anything that is derived from body and body products. So it could be vaccines, blood components, somatic cells, gene therapy, and recombinant therapeutic proteins. Now, the most biologics that we are using are recombinant therapeutic proteins. Now, these are essentially protein molecules that target specific sites in the immunopathogenesis pathway of the disease. Now, to understand biologics, we have to understand a little bit of the pathogenic pathways in different diseases. But I will try to limit myself. I don't want to talk too much about the pathology part of it, but I would like to give a snapshot. So we have different kinds of recombinant proteins, monoclonal antibodies, fusion antibody proteins, and recombinant human cytokines and growth factors. These are the broad category of biologics. Now, biologics were initially started as usage apart from insulin, which is used in diabetes. It was first started in rheumatoid arthritis when TNF-alpha inhibitors were made a big breakthrough products for improving the quality of life in rheumatoid arthritis and various arthritis. Now, off late, we've been using biologics in several skin conditions, and psoriasis, we have at least 10 to 12 biologic agents available currently. Then in chronic urticaria and allergic asthma, omalizumab, that's the next group of biologics that I would like to talk about. Then pemphigus vulgaris, I'm going to talk a little bit of rituximab, and we have newer biologics coming up for alopecia areata and also for atopic dermatitis. So these are the group of biologics that I'm going to talk about. So now we all treat urticaria, and we will come across urticaria at some part of our in every specialty. Now, urticaria is broadly divided into short-term or acute urticaria, for about which I'm not going to talk about. I'm going to talk about the chronic variety of urticaria, where they have this persistent itch and wheals that goes on for several months, years, and sometimes longer. So if you see a prescription from a general physician, is usually people tend to believe that steroids have a major role in the treatment of urticaria. But this is entirely wrong. And we hardly use as a dermatologist, I have trained in AIIMS, I have worked in several institutes. So we tend not to use steroids in chronic urticaria. Acute urticaria, where there's a short-lasting severe episode, there is a possibility of using steroids for a short time. But chronic urticaria is going to go on for months to years. Once we start on steroids for these patients, they're going to be dependent on steroids, and many times we see that the patient will not be taking antihistamine and he'll be only continuing steroids, and later he will blame us for developing diabetes, hypertension, or whatever complications that come out of steroids. So my request to this August audience is use steroids in acute urticaria but not in chronic urticaria. Now, so this is what I try to convey. Now, we all know that urticaria is a mast cell and IgE mediated disease. Now, what we see in chronic urticaria is that the mast cells are hypersensitive and hyperreactive. So these activated mast cells release histamine and other mediators. And the entire process is IgE mediated. There is a putative antigen, known or unknown, which binds to this IgE, which again binds to the F epsilon RI receptors and the mast cells. That leads to degranulation and release of histamines and other mediators that gives rise to symptoms of hives and injured edema. Now, so what do we have here? Now, we have a humanized monoclonal IgG antibody against the IgE. So we are targeting the IgE. So, and it is a humanized antibody. So 95% of the molecule is human derived. So what it does is it binds to the IgE in the body in circulation. So the IgE gets bound into trimers and hexamers, and it is prevented from activating the mast cells. So this is a normal phenomenon that's happening where the antigen is binding. Now, once you start omalizumab, you are effectively blocking this. So once the IgE is blocked, it cannot activate the mast cell. Now, this is the treatment algorithm for urticaria, and this is there from 2013, and even today it holds true. The first line treatment for chronic urticaria is a second generation antihistamine, that's levocetirizine, cetirizine, loratadine, desloratadine, and fexofenadine. So now, once a patient is not controlled with a normal dose of antihistamine, what's the next step? Is it steroid? No. So you have to step up the dose of antihistamine. The next step is to increase the dose of antihistamine. It is FDA approved to use antihistamine up to 4 times the licensed dosage. That is, if you are using cetirizine, you can use 10 mg up to 4 times. 4 times the normal dose. If you are using levocetirizine, you can use up to 20 mg per day. So if this doesn't work, what do you do? So now you have a choice of either giving a short dose of steroid, or using cyclosporine or montelukast has some minimal role, or the real agent which we are going to talk about is omalizumab. So these are a subset. Now, omalizumab is not for all patients with chronic urticaria. These are patients who have severe itching, who are not responding to your usual antihistamine, and you are updosing the antihistamine, and they are complaining that they are sleepy, they are unable to tolerate it, their quality of life goes down, and still they are not getting better. So these are the patients, and there is a big subset of these patients who are good candidates for omalizumab. So omalizumab is given as a subcutaneous injection once a month for about 6 months. Now this gives a very quick response, and the urticaria gets better within a period of about 2 weeks. There's a rapid reduction, and the results of the one dose of omalizumab lasts for about a month. So usually we give about 6 months, sometimes a little longer than that. So this is one of the breakthrough molecules for chronic urticaria in our common practice. So you can see that this is a chart comparing the comparing placebo versus omalizumab. You can see that by within 2 or 3 weeks there is a rapid response. And after stopping, but also we should note that this is not a permanent cure, or it works as long as you use it. Usually chronic urticaria has periods of exacerbations. This is the time when you use omalizumab. It is not curative for urticaria. So that is again a message that I would like to deliver here. Now, so that's about urticaria. The next group of disease that biologic that I would like to talk is pemphigus. Now, we might remember in our undergraduate days that pemphigus is an autoimmune disorder, and there is excessive antibodies produced against the target, which is desmoglein 1 and 3. Basically, these are cementing substances between cells. So this is a kind of an intercellular bridge. So destruction of these bridges causes the blister formation, and there is blistering throughout the body. So it is an antibody mediated autoimmune disease. So we knew that, you know, if you study, like, you know, emergencies and fatal cases in dermatology, pemphigus used to come. Later, the entire thing changed when we all knew that, you know, high dose steroid is the treatment of choice in femphigus. But the problem is that, the good thing is that we were able to reduce the mortality, but all these patients suffered more from the side effects of steroids rather than the disease itself. So another milestone in the treatment of femphigus was the use of dexamethasone cyclophosphamide as steroid pulse therapy. This was done in 1984, and a large series was published for AIDS, and subsequently that was the gold standard treatment for femphigus. So it lasted for almost 15 years to 20 years, that is the gold standard treatment for femphigus. But things have changed now, and we have this molecule. I mean, rituximab is not new to us, it has been used for multiple indications in multiple fields of medicine. So it is a monoclonal antibody that binds to B cells and inhibits the production of these anti-desmoglomal IgG antibodies. So it is basically an anti-B cell antibody, monoclonal antibody. It was first found that when a case of chronic myeloid leukemia, when the patient was chronic myeloid leukemia with paraneoplastic femphigus, when he was given rituximab, his femphigus improved very well. Now, paraneoplastic femphigus has very bad prognosis, doesn't improve even with very high dose steroids. So this was an indication to show that rituximab worked. Subsequently, many studies were published, and in 2010 in PGI Chandigarh, it was first used, and in 2012 it was published. And these are the words from that publication. It says that we are so impressed with the efficacy of rituximab that we started using it as first-line therapy in femphigus patients. It is very gratifying and satisfying to see patients with extensive skin and oral involvement coming for follow-up and telling the physician that they are completely okay. So these are the words from the article published in 2012, and this is almost 7 years back. Subsequently, it has been published in several articles. This is from Stanley Medical College, published some 2-3 years back. So undoubtedly, for femphigus is no longer steroids, it is rituximab. Now, I would like to talk about the third condition, is alopecia areata. Now, small patches of alopecia areata is not a major problem. Small patches, short duration, excellent improvement, 3 or 4 months. But there are a subset of alopecia who have complete loss of hair. Alopecia totalis, extensive alopecia, more than 50% hair loss. These patients was always a problem for the dermatologist. You may have to give high-dose steroids, maintain them on several immunosuppressants, give multiple therapies, but still they didn't have a good prognosis. So I'm not going too deep into it. So we see that the CD8 positive NKG2 T cells are the prime cells that accumulate around the anagen hair follicle in alopecia areata. So they produce this interferon gamma. Now this interferon gamma goes and binds to the JAK domain. This is an intracellular receptors for cytokine production. So once it is activated, it produces interleukin 15R, and that again stimulates the JAK to produce interferon gamma, and this is a cyclical change of why these cells are accumulating at the hair roots. Now, so the new group of medicines are JAK inhibitors. Again, JAK inhibitors are used in hematology and several other rheumatoid arthritis and several indications. So they block these JAK-STAT pathway and inhibiting gene expression and cytokine formation. So this is what I said. So now these are some recent studies of new 289, this is a cohort, which showed these are patients who have alopecia of more than 50%. More than 72% showed some improvement, 45% have good improvement, and so that's a very good improvement in a very pretty short time. So improvement, mean improvement was about 2.2 months. So these are some studies from Indian population. It's no longer only Western literature. These are people with extensive hair loss, including eyebrow loss, and this is children having alopecia areata. So it's an excellent biologic for resistant alopecia areata. The third is atopic dermatitis. Now, atopic dermatitis, luckily, is not a very significant or a very common condition in India, but US and Western world, this is a major condition, and this is the game changer. This is the publication article published last year. So dupilumab is a subcutaneous injection, weekly or once in 2 weeks, showing excellent result in moderate to severe psoriasis. Atopic dermatitis. So going to biologics and psoriasis. Now psoriasis, we have two problems. One is we don't have a medicine which is very safe, especially for people who have a little more than say 10%, where you can't just treat with topical therapy. So that was one problem. The second problem is people who have extensive involvement, so with full body involvement. How do we treat them? Because if they have a comorbidity, a liver dysfunction, or renal dysfunction, it is a very big task to treat them. So I don't want to go into the pathogenesis too much. Now these are the various interleukins and TNF-alpha. There are so many mediators that are important in psoriasis. So these specific cytokines are the targets for our biologic therapy, and we have, these are the number of biologics available for psoriasis. The bigger chunk is the TNF-alpha inhibitors. We see that, you know, adalimumab, infliximab, those are the TNF-alpha inhibitors. And the next group is the interleukin blockers. So specifically, secukinumab, which is a very good molecule available in the Indian market for almost 4 or 5 years and has been giving very good results in psoriasis. Yeah, so just a minute of your time. So this is the slide to show the efficacy of secukinumab versus etanercept and ustekinumab. Now the definition or the endpoint in our treatment is PASI 90. 90 is almost clear skin, and PASI 100 is completely clear skin. And we can see that secukinumab is able to give at least 40 to 50% having 100% clear skin, and 80% of them have at least PASI 90. So that's a good response, especially in people with extensive involvement. And the response is sustained for very long duration. After about a 1 year course of biologic, the response can last for up to 4 years. And it's a quick response. Within one dose, you can have a very good improvement. And so it is also very effective in psoriatic arthritis. Unlike TNF-alpha inhibitors, which have a little higher risk for TB infection, secukinumab is relatively safe, although the routine screening for viral markers and TB has to be done for every patient. So this is what it is. And the last, which I told, is the oral agent for psoriasis that doesn't need monitoring, doesn't have end organ damage, is apremilast. This tablet is only rupees 25. This can be given to psoriatics without the need for monitoring. It is very safe, is cost effective, it is as good as methotrexate, and it is one of the newer drugs for psoriasis, and it is a big boon to us. So in summary, so the newer biologics for psoriasis are very effective for extensive psoriasis. Apremilast is a wonder drug for us. Pemphigus is a treatment for pemphigus, it is rituximab, and several biologic markers come, biologic agents come coming for various diseases, including vitiligo in future. Any doubts? Yeah, now I have mentioned in my slides that cost is a limiting factor. Now secukinumab approximately comes to about 25,000 per month, and the duration of treatment is minimum about 6 months. Usually we tide over the crisis with secukinumab, and later on we have enough agents for maintenance. So when it's in a crisis situation, we find it to be very effective, quickly effective, and gratifying for patients. So if anybody can spend 25,000 per month, you can say that they can say that you can't even make out that he has psoriasis. That's about secukinumab. Omalizumab cost varies about 10 to 25,000. And you know, that's a subset where they have severe urticaria, don't want to take steroids, have other comorbidities. People who take it are very happy.
What is your success rate with the pemphigus vulgaris treatment? Can you know the patients repeatedly coming to you, or whether they are referring some cases to you?
I have personally treated at least 25 to 30 patients with rituximab.
So I want to know whether they are satisfied with the treatment, or they want to go to the alternative medicine.
It is a boon, I am telling you. They are the most satisfied patients. They are the most satisfied patients among all patients. And the thing is, sometimes they might need a repeat course after 1 year. To my experience, most of them didn't have more than two doses. That is, one dose in the first initially and one dose after a year.
You say that the repeat you have is so effective?
Excellent.
Because I have a patient, I am a pediatrician handling some dermatology practice.
Yeah.
Okay. The patient is seeing a lot of dermatologists in Annanagar. After taking 1 year of treatment, they came to me with a full pushing at faces, everything. It took me 1 month for her to bring her from the steroid effect. And I am treating her with antibiotics and not putting her on the steroid. I am giving her probiotics. Another thing, and she is slowly checking down, but she is having remissions and severe relapses the whole throughout the body. That's what I wanted to know, whether you are having satisfied patients' feedback, then I can refer to you.
See, it is going to be a life change. 100%.
That is very difficult for us to practice in the society. Because
see,
nowadays we have a lot of Googling everything. So they are not satisfied, they are analyzing all the alternative medicine. So wherever you are not strong, you are not able to give a correct treatment, the facts are flourishing. So we can't
Talk about quagmire of the people, some doctors are doing. But we must be honestly approving we don't have proper treatment. First stage.
Yeah.
Then only it is easy for the general practitioners to practice in the society. You people, the highest majority people must say we don't have proper treatment.
Alright, so see, that's why I try to emphasize that moving from a discovery in 2001, how it was used in a prime central institute in India, and they are making a statement publication that it is the first line of treatment in their department, and this is in 2010. Subsequently, AIIMS has published, and now I said I put a publication from Stanley Medical College where they say, and this is in 2017, if a government hospital can say that this is a boon, what else do you need? See, I practice in a corporate and a private. So we've been using this agent since many years than compared to a government hospital. If a government hospital, say Stanley Medical Colleges, publishes a series and says and gives the heading, it is a wound in fempigus, what else do you need?
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Dakshina Murthy to come and present a certificate of appreciation to Dr. Sohan. Let's move on to the next topic.